Okay, so first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for having invited me to give this keynote lecture. And this is, I'm going to give you a talk on some of the researches we have been doing in the last 20-25 years on the exploitation of microbial photosynthesis for developing environmental sustainable biotechnological processes and products. First of all, I would like to introduce the microbial photosynthesis. Most probably you are aware that there are two different kinds of microbial photosynthesis. The first one is the so-called oxygenic photosynthesis, carried out by cyanobacteria and microalgae, but we focused our activities mostly on cyanobacteria for two different kinds of application. The first one is to produce green biopolymers, in particular polysaccharides that we studied for many years. And the other application that we study is to develop green biotechnologies based on the possibility to use the EPS producing the cyanobacteria biomass for developing a process for the heavy metal bioabsorption from wastewaters or for the rehabilitation of arid and desert soils. And the second activity that we did was dedicated to the anoxygenic photosynthesis, in particular by studying pulp bacteria in order to develop technologies based on their capability to utilize the energy coming from the sun and the reducing power coming from organic compounds for producing green biohydrogen by a very specific process based on the activity of this enzyme nitrogenase. First of all, from starting from the first topic, let's introduce you some characteristics of the exopolysaccharide producing cyanobacteria. You can find in cyanobacteria three different polysaccharidic structures. The first one is called sheath, which is a thin layer surrounding single cells or filaments. You can have capsules, which are thick and slimy layers surrounding single cells again or filaments. And you can have also slime, which is a mucilaginous material loosely connected with single cells and filaments. Some of them may still have capsules. In all the three cases, you can have the release of polysaccharides into the culture medium, obtaining the so-called released polysaccharide RPS, which is soluble in water. And you see here, for instance, in this picture, a very young culture without a lot of polysaccharides into the culture medium. And this is an old culture with a lot of polysaccharide released into the culture medium. The synthesis of these very complex molecules, of course, starts from CO2. They are autotrophic microorganisms, cyanobacteria. And so you have the fixation of CO2 through the Calvin cycle to produce sugars. And then the sugars are activated, becoming sugar nucleotides, which are transferred via glucose transferases to the plasma membrane, where you find a lot of different proteins and they were quite complex system for producing, for polymerizing the monosaccharides produced inside the cell and for excreting the polysaccharide outside the outer membrane. So you can find this in the outer layers or even in the culture medium, as I mentioned before. Most of the polysaccharides are very, very complex. Here you have the example of one of the repeating units. You see they are composed by 8 different sugars. And also they are very complex in terms of kind of monosaccharides that you can find in a polysaccharide produced by a cyanobacterium. You can find usually from 6 to 12 or 13 different kind of monosaccharides. You can find their exoses, such as glucose, galactose, and mannose. You can find pentoses, such as arabinose, ribose, and xylose. But you can also find the oxysources, like fucose and rhamnose. And they are typically hydrophobic molecules. And you can find hydrophilic molecules, such as acidic azoses, like glucuronic acid and galacturonic acid. But you have also, in many cases, other constituents, such as the hydrophilic groups, sulfate and pyruvate, or the hydrophobic groups, such as acetate and peptidic moieties. So one of the characteristics of these macromolecules is their amphiphilic behavior. So they have areas that are hydrophobic and areas that are hydrophilic. The molecular weight is usually very high, up to more than 3 million dalton. You can find very, very large macromolecules. So let's see some of the possible applications that we studied in the last few years. The first one is based on their very interesting property, rheological properties. They are capable of inducing a very high viscosity to water. So in this study, we compared, for instance, the viscosity of the different polymers extracted from different cyanobacteria with one of the most utilized polysaccharides produced by microorganisms, xanthan gamma. And you see here that the viscosity in some cases are very, very interesting. But also another very interesting property of some of these polysaccharides is the stability in terms of viscosity in a large area of pH, and also in terms of resistance to the variation of temperature, which are both properties very interesting for applications, for instance, as food additives or something like that. Another very interesting characteristic of this polysaccharide, as I mentioned before, is the presence of sulfate group. In particular, they can reach very high concentration of sulfate groups, up to 20% of the polysaccharide dry weight. And these groups are very important because they are capable of conferring to these polymers effect of stimulation of immune system. For instance, we published this study on the stimulating effect on the immune system of shrimps 20 years ago now. But they also have activities against a number of viruses or also against some tumor cell lines. So they can have a very interesting application in medical applications. There are also other interesting properties that can be exploited for other applications. They are have been studied for cell therapy and tissue engineering, and also for their anti-inflammatory effect, which was considered one of the most interesting, particularly for cosmetic applications. As I mentioned before, we also studied the possibility to use these cyanobacteria, EPS-producing cyanobacteria, for developing processes to exploit and to develop a new way for removing heavy metals from wastewaters. The idea was based on the fact that, as I mentioned before, most of the EPS produced by cyanobacteria are characterized by the presence of uronic acids. That means that they have a negative charge, which is capable of interacting quite easily with the metal cations. And due to the presence of the capsules, but also to the release of the polysaccharides into the culture medium. We did several studies on that, but I will show you only shortly some of the results we obtained in two different studies made with wastewater, industrial wastewater. The first one was really challenging because it was a very high concentration of chromium 6 in wastewater produced by a plating company. We used one Nostoc strain, and actually the challenge of this kind of application was to have not cation, as I mentioned before, but oxyanion, which is typically the form, the chemical form of chromium 6 at very low pH. And the other one was the use of another cyanobacterium, in this case unicellular one, for recovering gold from wastewaters. In the first case, we observed very interesting results by using, we used three different devices for treating the wastewaters. The first one is a filter press. It's composed by a stack, as you can see here, a stack of paper filters interleaved with a paper checkboard. And in the first we saturated all the filters with the biomass by flushing into the system cell suspension coming from a culture of a nostoc, and then we flushed the filters saturated with the biomass with the wastewater, and we removed the chromium from wastewater. In the second case, we used a filter column filled up with the coarse sand, saturated with the, again with the biomass by circulating the culture, and then we treated the wastewater by flushing the wastewater into the system. The third one was a static system. We put the culture here inside this device with these dialysis membranes, and in the tank we put the wastewater, and we followed the removal of chromium. In this case, we removed the chromium at 95-96%. In this case, we removed the chromium at 50% more or less, and the other 50% of chromium was present as chromium 3. So we had a reduction from 6 to 3, and chromium 3 is much less toxic than chromium 6. And in the case of filter column, we we only observed a change of oxidation degree of the chromium from 6 to 3. And we still had a lot, all the chromium present in solution as chromium 3. We explained this with a very complex mechanism that you can find if you are interested in the paper we published now 10 years ago. The second good point of this treatment was that we were able to recover the metal from the biomass. We burned the biomass, and then we analyzed the ashes, and we found that the ashes are around more than 90% of the weight of the ashes was composed by chromium. So you have very high concentrated chromium in the ashes, so that you can reuse the chromium in the ashes for the industrial application in the plating industry. So you can use your waste in some way. In the case of gold, we did the same kind of experiments, but in this case, as you can see from the results were not so promising. We remained at around 2.4-2.5% the concentration of gold in the ashes. So we still have to work on it, and we hope that we'll be able to increase this kind of recovery percentage. Another environmental application we studied in the last 10 years is the use of polysaccharide producing cyanobacteria for inoculating desert soils. These kind of studies were started in the beginning of this century by a Chinese group, a very important Chinese group headed by Professor Liu Yongding, and we collaborated with him since the 2-3 years after his starting of these studies. Actually, they use this technique by they cultivate large volume of EPS producing cyanobacteria. They inoculate them on sand dunes, and then they after a few weeks they start observing the development of a biocrust, the biological soil crust, which is composed by cyanobacterial filaments and also by the polysaccharides that they release as forming the EPS matrix. If you look at this more in deep, with the electron microscopy, you see here these are the sand particles connected by a network of filaments that are due to the formation of the growth of the cyanobacteria, filamentous cyanobacteria. They use particularly two different filamentous cyanobacteria, but you see also the role of the polysaccharides that is capable of connecting and making a sort of glue between all the sand particles. When we entered into the in collaboration with Professor Liu Yongding and his group, we were mostly interested in investigating the role of EPS matrix, the polysaccharide that is produced by these cyanobacteria that are the first colonizers of the soil, and then followed some years ago by the colonization of other organisms. But in the first months and year, you can find almost only the cyanobacteria that were introduced. Actually, we studied the capability of the polysaccharidic matrix, the contribution of the polysaccharidic matrix to affect the hydrological behavior of the sand, of the biocrust. And particularly, we started with studying the humidity uptake from the atmosphere. You see here the water uptake obtained with the biocrust, impact biocrust, or with the sand underlying, the bare sand underlying the crust. Here you see the structural biocrust. I mean, these are the first the studies we did first with the biocrust, intact biocrust. Then we destructed the crust in order to understand if it was important or not to have this structure. And again, we still found that the crust is capable of uptaking much more water than the bare soil. But if you remove the polysaccharide, I mean, if you extract the polysaccharide from the structured biocrust, you can see that the difference in the water uptake is statistically not significantly different. So the polysaccharidic matrix is essential for the uptake of water. We also studied the water holding capacity of the biocrust, saturating the biocrust with water, and then measuring the decrease of the relative water content in the time after having put the biocrust in an oven at 30 degrees. This is the biocrust, complete biocrust with a polysaccharide. This is the biocrust after the extraction of polysaccharide. And you can see that the kinetics of decrease of water is much slower in the presence of the polysaccharide. But even more important than that is the measurement of the water, the results we obtained by measuring the water potential of the biocrust. Water potential is an important, very important property, because it's a sort of proxy for understanding how the water is available in the soil for the microbial community living there, or also for the plants if they are there. So you can see that in the presence of the polysaccharides, we still had a very high and constant water potential, even at a very low relative water content, down to 20% more or less of the initial amount. In the case of the crust without polysaccharide, you see the sharp decrease, particularly after the 50-40% of relative water content. So this means that you have a very important contribution of the polysaccharide in the maintaining this water potential at a high level. Another important contribution is the polysaccharidic matrix is connected with the soil aggregation. We measured soil aggregation with two different methods. One is the aggregate stability, the other one is the tensile strength, I mean the energy that you need for breaking the biocrust. And you can see the comparison without entering into the details of the differences between this measurement done on the biocrust, which are the biocrust were maintaining a different level of humidity during their growth. But in any case, all the biocrust showed much higher aggregate stability or tensile strength in comparison with the control, which was the bare sand without any induction of the biocrust. We also investigated in deep the different characteristics of the polysaccharide matrix. Actually, we found there three different kind of fractions connecting the sand particles. So you can see here, this is the glycocalic EPS, which is the name that we gave to the polysaccharides surrounding cells and filaments in terms of as a sheath or capsule. We had another fraction we called loosely bound EPS, which is released in the area between the soil particles and which is easily soluble and extractable with water. And the other fraction is the tightly bound EPS. You see here tightly attached to soil particles and also to filaments. And it's very difficult to extract this fraction, and you have to use EPA, EDTA solutions. And the very interesting point that we found that these two fractions had a different role. This one is showed a lower percentage of high molecular weight polysaccharide and around between 20 and 30% of polysaccharide with a low molecular weight that can be used by the microorganisms living in the crust after some time, chemoheterotrophic microorganisms. And in the case of tightly bound, you have a very high molecular weight, around 70 to 80% of the polysaccharides composed by a fraction having from 1 to 2 million Dalton, and is really very important for attaching the sand particles and for maintaining water into the biocrust. Moving to the last application that we studied, actually, as I mentioned before, we study how to exploit an oxygenic photosynthesis for obtaining hydrogen. So how to convert the energy coming from the sun by using a microorganism capable of capturing this energy and to convert it into hydrogen, which is an energy carrier, very important for the future of our planet to have energy carriers with a very low environmental impact. And in this case, we developed and we studied the possibility to exploit an oxygenic photosynthesis. And you know that you have this photosynthesis based on the capture of energy from light, of course, but also the capability of oxidizing organic compounds such as low molecular weight fatty acids, and to convert to obtain these electrons, so reducing power that are channeled to the nitrogenase capable of producing hydrogen. Make a very short, much longer history. One key point of this kind of processes is to have capability to exploit them under outdoor condition by exploiting the solar light. So we did some experiments outdoors with photobioreactor with a light intensity, partially shading the photobioreactor with a light intensity of around 700 microangstrom per square meter per second. And when you have you make this kind of experiments, usually you have to come to calculate the light conversion efficiency, which is the ratio between the free energy of the total amount of hydrogen produced divided by the total energy of the light incident on the culture. And theoretically, due to the composition, to the characteristic of the solar light, to the light that can be really utilized by photosynthetic pigments of this organism, and to the mechanism of production of reducing power, the maximum theoretical value in the case of photosynthetic microorganisms around 11%, and the results obtained so far outdoors are, you can see here, around 1%. These are our study, but the most important results we obtained, we observed that the the culture, in spite of the fact that these are organisms living in an environment in a low level of light irradiation, the photosynthetic efficiency was maintained very nicely during all the production period. You see here, this is the red line is the photosynthetic efficiency obtained under optimal conditions in lab conditions, and the other one, this the photosynthetic efficiency in the experiments done outdoors. After 2-3 days of adaptation, you see that the photosynthetic efficiency was maintained very high. So this all was quite a surprising results. We investigated more for understanding the reason of these results, and actually, again, making very short, a long, much longer history, we realized by comparing the photosynthetic efficiency obtained to 250 compared with 1,500 microangstrom per square meter per second, we compared two different kind of conditions, growth conditions. The first one is anaerobic growth condition. That means that we used a culture medium that was not suitable for producing hydrogen, but suitable for growing. And you see that increasing the radiation, you have a much lower photosynthetic efficiency than in a low light irradiation. But changing the condition, making using a culture medium suitable for the production of hydrogen, you can see that the photosynthetic efficiency was maintained at the same level. And we explained this in the paper that was published 4 or 5 years ago now, that the capability of getting rid of the excess of reducing power in the presence of when the production of hydrogen is possible is much, much more efficient than when it's only possible the biosynthetic activity for the microorganisms. So this means that we can take advantage of the increase of solar irradiation for increasing the hydrogen production rate. You can see here, this is 1,500 microangstrom. This is 250, much higher in this case. So concluding, there are many, many other points to investigate, but I would like to stress these key points, general key points. The first one, that for really using this organism for developing industrially relevant bioprocesses, you have to optimize the performances of phototrophic microorganisms. Probably the most important point will be to develop metabolically engineering methods for improving the microorganisms. You have to optimize the light distribution in photobioreactors, and you have to reduce the cost of the industrial biotechnological processes. So I came to the conclusion. I only want to show some of the people that made a PhD or postdocs in my lab. You see here, this are all the collaboration we had on the side of cyanobacteria, and the same for the activities on hydrogen. Again, the postdocs or former PhD in my lab and all the collaborations. And finally, I would like to thank you for your attention.